Innovation. It charges our imagination, fuels our progress, and builds bridges that span oceans. It turns our wildest hopes and dreams into reality. It powers our movement, creates new worlds to explore, and gives birth to new jobs and new industries. There's only one place and one event where the world's greatest creators and purveyors of innovation meet. This is where ordinary comes to die. Expectations are shattered. This is the 2015 International CES. Innovation is here.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President and CEO of the Consumer Electronics Association, Gary Shapiro.
Thank you, and welcome to the 2015 International CES, where innovation comes to market. You know, CES stands totally for innovation and the promise and the power of technology. It's a platform for all innovators, large and small, especially the small. That's what the show is designed for. In fact, Eureka Park Marketplace this year, which last year had 220 exhibitors, this year has 375 startups. Companies excited with a new product or idea, and they'll expose it to thousands and thousands of investors, retailers, partners, and others. You know, for several years, on stage, the message has been about innovation, because innovation defines CES. I've stood up here and I've said, innovate or die. I said it in 2010 and beyond. And my, how the world has changed since then. Some companies have left us. Others have been created since then, and they've gone public or sold for billions of dollars. Going back, in the 1970s, we used to talk about CES as an entertainment show. In the 1980s, our products expanded to information and education in the digital world. And in the 1990s, wireless and the internet created whole new opportunities for new businesses. By the turn of the century, we survived the dot-com bomb, the dot-com boom, Y2K, 9/11, and the 2008 economic collapse. But one constant pushed us forward, and that was innovation. Today's International CES is totally focused on innovation and where we are going towards the future. And indeed, this CES, this 2015 CES, is one for the record books. Over 3,600 companies are exhibiting in more than 2.2 million net square feet of exhibit space. And we expect between 150,000 and 160,000 people from the trade to come from around the world. In fact, one out of four people coming to CES is from outside the United States. We have shifted from a trade show focusing on hi-fi makers and buyers to an innovation event attracting content creators, broadcasters, Hollywood, big companies, small companies, Madison Avenue, Wall Street, Detroit, Germany, France, journalists, retailers, investors, and all those who thrive on innovation. Each January, from this stage, we assess where we are from the world's most important and largest gathering of innovation connoisseurs. And based on this CES, let me tell you, we are in a really good place. Just last night on this stage, we heard from Samsung's BK Yoon, and he presented a tremendous vision of the future. And after that, across town, Mercedes' Dieter Zetsche gave an extraordinary keynote. And in terms of where we're going, we're forecasting that in the United States this year, sales will break $223 billion in consumer electronics. That's up 3% from last year. And where is that coming from? Look at those emerging products like 3D printing, 4K Ultra HD, unmanned systems, and wearables, which will grow 108% this year to an $11 billion marketplace. These are products which didn't even exist a few years ago. Now, at this 2015 CES, We see a future where many of the biggest problems that humans face will be solved with innovative technology. Think about it. Healthcare for all humans will improve with wireless sensing and diagnostic devices. Everything from senior care to helping those with disabilities will benefit. And they'll benefit from devices which connect to sensors which monitor and assess them. Indeed, CEA is so passionate about the potential in this area that we are investing some $10 million in the CEA Foundation. The foundation's purpose is to use technology to improve the lives of seniors and people with disabilities. Another promising area is how we get what we need. Think about it. Today's world, you have two choices. You can go out to a store and buy what you want, or you can order it online and it'll be delivered to you in a delivery truck with a driver. Well, you can tell from this CES that we will soon have three other choices. We can have products dropped off by driverless cars, like one we saw last night with Mercedes-Benz. Of course, these cars will dramatically cut car deaths and injuries. Last night, Mercedes had this tremendous car. It was the first ever concept car created just for CES, and it had so many features and functions, but what it clearly will do is a step to the future of a totally safe driving world. And this extraordinarily beautiful vision of Mercedes will be remembered as the first groundbreaking, feature-laden driverless vehicle. But even before we have driverless cars in the road, we are seeing innovators rapidly create and deploy solutions to the problems of other distractions, drowsiness or drunkenness. This innovation underscores why we have a record 10 major automakers at CES this year. And indeed, CEA is releasing this week a listing of 50 new products designed to cut car accidents. You know, we will get to the driverless car, but along the way, we must be wary of government efforts to distort technology with new rules banning products from cars. Now, I mentioned that the first three ways you can get things to your home, from buying them yourself to ordering online, a driverless car. A fourth way we will get products we need is from unmanned aerial vehicles, also known as UAVs or drones. These products can find lost hikers, they can check oil pipelines, and they can deliver medicine to remote areas and give new perspective to news and movies. They could also cut city congestion via rooftop deliveries. But we must focus, of course, on real concerns that drones raise about safety and privacy. And I think we're on the way to doing that. And I'm very hopeful that the FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration, will act expeditiously and announce an approach for the United States which balances safety with the many benefits of this exciting new category. Now, there's a fifth way we're going to get products, is to create them ourselves in our homes and our offices with 3D printers. What started out as a tool for rapid prototyping is expanding to food, to clothes, and even to artificial limbs. And we're just at the beginning. Our world is changing, and the CES is where you are seeing the future. In fact, we've tried to jiggle some things up by making the show easier to navigate. We've divided it essentially into three big areas. Tech West is right here in the Venetian and Sands. You'll find many of the newer categories, Eureka Park and high-end audio. Tech East is the Las Vegas Convention Center, the Renaissance, and Westgate, which used to be called the Hilton. There you'll find automotive electronics, video, the network home, and many other exciting categories. And there's a totally new area of the show called C-Space. It's at the Aria Hotel. It's for content creators, marketers, and service providers. We've also created areas of the show called marketplaces. We used to call them tech zones, but now they're marketplaces. And there you can experience entire categories of innovation. And we have over 20 of those. New for this year marketplaces are personal privacy, smart home, sports tech, streaming content, and unmanned systems, or the drones. Marketplaces returning from last year with double-digit growth include 3D printing, fitness technology, gaming, health and fitness, and wearables. Now, late last year, we announced a whole new venture in another part of the world, CES Asia. International CES Asia is building momentum with already several blue chip companies have signed on to exhibit. It's focused on innovative products and companies with a strong brand seeking to build their Asian business. We'll have 8,500 net square meters of exhibit space, and we'll have major product categories, including 3D printing, robotics, sensors, the Internet of Things, and wearables. And Audi AG chairman Rupert Stadler will deliver a pre-show keynote address. In fact, today, registration for the CES Asia website is open. You can go there and you can register beginning today. Now, as an organization, the Consumer Electronics Association is a nonprofit trade association based in the Washington, D.C. area. We use every tool possible to promote innovation, from our trade shows to our public policy. That's why, from this stage at prior CES shows, we launched two books, The Comeback, How Innovation Will Restore the American Dream, and Ninja Innovation. Now, I am so excited to announce our third book, one that I did not author, called Digital Destiny, How the New Age of Data Will Transform the Way We Work, Live, and Communicate. And it's authored by the great CEA chief economist, Dr. Sean Dubrovec. Now, in the book, Sean draws on more than 15 years of experience examining trends in the consumer technology industry. Digital Destiny doesn't just predict future technologies or trends, it actually unveils a future in which digital data will solve many of our thorniest problems. It will also create new challenges and transform life totally as we know it. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Sean Dubrovec to the CES stage to discuss CEA's new book. Sean, welcome to the CES stage. So, what is our digital destiny and what do you want readers to take away from this book?
Digitization, sensorization, and connection are the biggest game-changing trends we've seen since the introduction of the printing press in 1450. And just like the introduction of the printing press in 1450, these trends will forever change the way we get things done, the way we live, and the way we communicate. They're changing all of the objects that are around us. These everyday things are being pulled into the fabric of consumer electronics. The book is about the implications of these trends on every one of us.
And how do you see these trends playing out at CES?
You see it playing out in every single corner of CES. Just look at the auto manufacturers. 10 years ago, there were hardly any auto manufacturers at CES. Today, they're a driving force. As we digitize, sensorize, and connect all of these adjacent categories and pull them into the consumer electronics environment, they become part of the storyline.
That's great. Let's go forward 10 years and see what are we going to see at CES and other shows then?
So the explosion of these trends and the explosion of them into everyday objects is going to forever change the things that we do, and it will change the services that we engage in. So take, for example, something like a Netflix, which today looks at your viewer history and some basic demographics to make recommendations on the type of things that you might want to watch. But in the future, if a service like Netflix had access to, say, a drop cam in your room, they could see how many people were in the room, whether you were standing up, whether you were sitting down. They could see how dark it was. If they had access to a wearable device that told them how stressed you were or how excited you were, then they could see that as well. Taking your Nest thermostat, they might know how cold it is inside. So now all of a sudden, they pull this information together and they can provide much more robust recommendations, arguably even predictive recommendations that deviate from your history. So they might see that it's cold inside, that it's dark, you're alone, you're depressed, you're lying down. And so they say, hey, you might really like this Nicholas Sparks movie as opposed to something that's more based upon your viewer history.
If you like Nicholas Sparks, will my bed or my chair tell me, for example, that I'm getting sick and I should take corrective action?
Everything becomes predictive and it pulls it in. So today we do a great job of looking in the past. How many steps did I take? What happened during the day? In the future, 10 years from now, will become much more predictive. They'll pull in your calendar, which is also digital. They'll look at your bed, which becomes digital and has information. Chairs will be able to convey information. They'll pull all of this together and they'll say, hey, we see all of these things moving forward and it's suggesting this. We don't know for certain, but I think we'll start to live in a world of probability. There's an 85% chance that this is gonna happen. There's a 74% chance that this will happen. And all of these things will start to make recommendations. The more things that we digitize, sensorize, and connect, the better that these predictive engines will become.
Probably change Las Vegas betting, won't it?
It'll change everything, and that's the essence of the book, that everything changes.
Well, that's terrific. Thank you so much, Sean, and good luck with the book.
Thank you, Gary.
That's great. So Digital Destiny goes on sale January 12th, but you can pick up a pre-release copy of the book at Gary's Book Club in the Grand Lobby in the Las Vegas Convention Center. Well, as Sean notes, innovation is certainly our destiny. And as excited as I am about the future, we do have to be careful. It is not preordained. States and even countries all want to be centers of innovation. Yet they often allow old laws protecting old business models to hurt innovators like Airbnb or Uber. You can't get Uber in Las Vegas thanks to some rather difficult laws we're trying to change here. These laws restrict investment, they impose bureaucracy, or they discourage a flexible workplace, which is necessary for innovation. CEA is trying to do its job to change these laws. In fact, what we're doing soon is we'll be releasing a ranking of the 50 different states in the United States based on how innovation-friendly they are. But even innovation-friendly countries like the United States, which is one of the most innovative countries in the world, we can do better. We can change our immigration laws to get and keep the best and the brightest. We could stop patent troll extortion. We could clarify ambiguous laws. And best of all, if we can reach this dream, we could ask lawyers to consider other lines of work. And we must encourage investment to get real competition in fast broadband. What the battle over net neutrality is missing is that we need both an open internet and a huge investment in infrastructure. Our spectrum must be auctioned for broadband, but we also need unlicensed spectrum to allow the real fuel of innovation to move forward. So I'll say it again, innovate or die, it really is that simple. There will always be the naysayers, because innovation by its very nature disrupts the status quo. And that can be scary to those with an existing line of work or an old industry. But at the end of the day, innovation is about making the human condition better. It's about making our planet better, and it's about solving the most fundamental problems in food production, hunger, clean water, healthcare that are really plaguing the world. Those of us living in the developed world, we take for granted the fact that we have all these things, that we're not hungry, that we have healthcare, where technology is rapidly going to solve these problems for the whole world. And it's about making us as individuals better. You can walk the show floor this week, and I urge you to talk to the innovators and the entrepreneurs, and I guarantee you will find something that will totally blow your mind. You'll find something that will make your life better. You will see that we have an amazing CES and a bright future. But as much as we're focused on the future, I want to dwell one moment on the past, and let me talk about a true innovator. My predecessor, Jack Wayman, he created CES with a vision in 1967. He passed away this summer at the age of 92. He mentored me and many others, and he asked that he be remembered for a life well lived. Jack taught me that as great as all our technology is, there is nothing like the 5 cents here and now, look him in the eye, touch and feel experience of a trade show. Jack, we salute you, we remember you, and we thank you. And now here is some sage advice from Jack.
So I hope that the future, beyond Gary, beyond the staff, will have the same keeping the faith. The original purpose of the show is to stay slightly ahead of this industry, but not too far ahead.
Jack gave us a path to the future, and we honor him today by fighting for the cause of innovation. And I also want to honor him by respecting the fact that he always said, keep it on time. So now I'm going to go to the opening keynote speaker. Now, while 2015 is the first time that Mark Fields will deliver a keynote address at the International CES, this company is no stranger to the stage. Indeed, Mark and Ford have been here many times before. In fact, we went back in history and discovered Mark was the very first Ford executive to participate in a CES keynote when he joined with Bill Gates to introduce Sync in January 2007 during Microsoft's keynote. Sync was a breakthrough because it allowed you to move seamlessly from the connected world contained in your phone to an equally connected one inside your car with just a single touch of a button. Mark was involved in the development of Sync from the beginning. Recognizing a clear opportunity to offer Ford customers a differentiated experience, Mark put Sync on the fast track, and he's described the introduction of Sync as a defining moment within Ford. At a time when the automotive company was started thinking and behaving actually more like a technology company. In fact, 3 years later, Fast Company said Sync technology was turning Ford into, quote, America's most surprising consumer electronics company. Today, Sync is the most popular communications and entertainment connectivity system in the industry, with more than 10 million Sync-equipped cars and trucks on the road. And just last month, Ford announced the latest generation of its Sync 3 driver connectivity technology, and its core automotive business continues to grow. Its F-150 pickup truck remains the best-selling vehicle in America for 33 years straight. Its Fusion, midsize, and Escape compact utility vehicle are also coming off record-setting years. Mark Fields became president and CEO of Ford Motor Company last July. But prior to that, he served as Ford's chief operation officer. And throughout his 25 years with the company, Mark has run a number of Ford operations around the world. And today, we have the pleasure of hearing more about how Mark and the team are driving innovation throughout Ford. Please welcome Ford President and CEO, Mark Fields.